is what my estate plan looks like. In a nice, tidy little binder, table of contents. So whatever I'm looking for, it's right there, easy to find, tabbed. John and his staff really did it up, really made this process simple. And whoever wants to hear all about my wishes, right on down to the people who can make decisions on my behalf should I become incapacitated. This was the biggest thing that brought me to you initially, because I've been in a situation where I've been in a long-term relationship with somebody. We actually lived together, but we had no legal documents. We weren't married. And he ended up in the hospital through an accident. They would not give me any information on his condition. It was very unsettling and nerve-wracking. I didn't get to see him for 2 days. It was not a great experience, and it really brought to light I need to do something pragmatic to ensure that if something were to happen to me or my current significant other, that we're able to speak on each other's behalf and be there for each other. Tell me a little bit about what type of documents I need to have in place to ensure something like that doesn't happen again.
Oh, that's a great question. And for that particular situation, the hospital is not going to let you in. They're not going to tell you any information unless you have the right documents. I would say the documents that you would need in that situation would certainly be a healthcare power of attorney that basically says, okay, this is who the doctors can talk to make medical decisions for me if I can't make them myself. Mm-hmm. You would probably need a living will. God forbid it was an end of life situation, but what your wishes were in that situation. And the third thing you would need would be what's called a HIPAA consent form. Oh. That's who the doctors can talk to.
Right.
You know, so if you had been on a list, and he might have gotten in the hospital and not filled out any kind of paperwork like that when he went into the hospital. So mm-hmm. I usually do one as part of the plan that says, okay, if I do go into the hospital, here's who the doctors can talk to in that situation. And that kind of leads me to another idea, which is, what is this whole idea of incapacity? I not only prepare documents that take care of what happens if I pass away, mm-hmm. but also what happens if I'm incapacitated, and in just incapacity, just in kind of layman's terms is you're, for either through an accident or an illness or something like that, you're not able to take care of yourself or your finances. And you need somebody else to do that. If you don't have any documents in place, then the only way to have somebody kind of appointed to do that is to go to court. Mm. And that's expensive and takes time, and nobody wants to do that. If you have documents in place, you can alleviate the need to go to court, and you can just spell it out exactly who you want to be in charge, and you can even have backup choices. Those are really critical. For instance, who's going to pay your bills if you're if you are in a terrible accident and you're in the hospital for several weeks? Who's going to make medical decisions for you?
Mm-hmm.
So those kind of things are really important. And what I recommend really, to deal with incapacity is four documents in particular. One is what's called a durable general power of attorney. Okay, that's a financial power of attorney that says, okay, if I can't pay the bills and I'm incapacitated, here's who can pay them for me. You'll find out, real quick, with just your APS bill. If you were incapacitated, you have an account and an APS in your name, and somebody wants to call on your behalf and say, hey, we need to make this change or there was an error, they won't talk to them without a power of attorney.
Mm-hmm.
Even something as simple as that.
Wow.
And even if you're married, they won't talk to you.
Wow.
The other thing is the healthcare power of attorney, everybody kind of knows, it only kicks in if you can't make the medical decisions yourself. But that healthcare agent is the one that would make those decisions for you. God forbid there's ever kind of an Alzheimer's or dementia type situation, which I prepare documents like that for everybody. But I have a mental health care power of attorney that deals with who's going to help you with those kind of decisions if you need to, and in particular placement decisions, where you would live, and how you'd be taken care of. And all those things are things that people usually don't think of when they're thinking about a will. But they're just as important, because you need to plan for incapacity if that ever happens.
Absolutely.
Just as much as you need to plan for passing away.
Tell me a little bit about transparency. I know some people, they are divorced, they're split kids, maybe kids from different moms
right,
or dads.
Right, right.
have, what does transparency have to do with their situation, and how important is that?
I think the question really is, you know, how can we, in drafting the documents, is there anything we can do to really make it a more peaceful transition, you know? And the answer is yes. I think, certainly having well-organized documents in place to begin with helps a whole lot, right? I mean, that's the first step, you know? And then second of all, there needs to be some communication among the family, you know, about kind of who's going to be in charge. That often helps a lot in terms of having a conversation, for mom and dad to have a conversation. They don't need to say exactly what the distribution is, but they can say, you know, we've got our documents updated. We've decided to put, you know, Joe or Sally or whoever in charge, you know, this or two people in charge. Here's where we're keeping them. If you have any questions, you know, and here's John's name. You know, sometimes they give my card too to say, you know, here's who you need to talk to if something ever happens, and they can help you through that.